everybody, and welcome to the KTPF Community Show, live in the hub at www.ktpf.co.uk, the online paranormal talk show brought to you in association with the UK Shadow Seekers and the Keeping the Paranormal Friendly Community. Hi, my name is Suzanne.
And I'm Steve.
Established since 2007, the KTPF is a dedicated ongoing community which is not just there for when you're experiencing animosity from others. We welcome every paranormal investigator and enthusiast alike, including hobbyists, scientists and psychic mediums from around the globe, to join in as we cover this vast, fascinating subject, encouraging you to share information, advice and most importantly, friendship. Remember, collaboration, not competition.
Talk radio. You hear us, we hear you.
Yeah, welcome to the show, ladies and gentlemen. We're here on the KTPF Community Radio Show. I hope you can hear us all out there in the hub. And we have got a show for you. So please, if you are in there, we hope you enjoy the show. Later on, as I said...
They're all popping in now.
Yeah, they're all popping in now. We have got a show. There's a fantastic programme on Sky Television as we speak every Monday night where you can see a group of six investigators that are going round after watching viral footage on YouTube and checking out to see whether it's fact or faked. Yeah, we'll be having Ben Hansen on round about 8:30. I'll be calling him up on Skype for an interview with him, so please stay tuned for that.
Yeah, they dig out all these videos and see if they can get some background and some proper evidence from people that actually saw it.
Well, this is it. And don't forget, you too can get involved in our conversations with our guests live in the hub, as well as on the telephone. If you want to ask Ben Hansen any question, you can give us a call on 0844 414 3982. You can also give us a message in the chat room, but we have only got 30 minutes with Ben because he's a very, very busy man, and I think we're catching him in his dinner hour, to be honest with you.
Yeah, it'd be about 1 o'clock his time, wouldn't it?
Yeah, well, 1:30, 1:30, I think it is.
Half one o'clock.
Yeah, 1:30 it'll be. So stay tuned for that. Let's see, who have we got? We've got Nigel333. They say, hi, Shadow One. Yeah. And
we got Reiki Debs.
And we got Simply Joe, she's on as well. Yep. We've also got... Ghost Rider there somewhere, I should think. I think Nigel is Nigel Mortimer, if I believe. It's our guest for next week, Neil.
There's
talking about sundials.
Friend of yours, John.
And the
yeah,
portals.
Good friend of mine. Yeah.
and of course, we've got Sue73.
Yes, and just to let you know who we have got in the hub, we have Mr. John Hall, Fortean researcher, aren't you?
So I've been told.
So he's been told. Well, that's what I saw it as, anyway.
Hello to all our listeners. Yeah.
He says he knows a lot about the folklore and things like that. That's your big area, isn't it, John? That and UFOs.
Absolutely anything weird and wonderful and interesting. Absolutely anything at all.
You've come to the right place then.
Yeah.
There's plenty of weird and wonderful things in this house.
Yeah, definitely. Okay.
And of course, we have Mr. Whispering Neil Munnerley.
Hello again.
Whispering,
in case you're wondering,
even though I don't whisper.
In case you're wondering why we call him Whispering, when he's doing the circle and doing the meditation, he speaks so quiet. We have to actually come out in the meditation to hear what he's saying. It's like, speak up, Neil, we can't hear you. and of course, we should have had our good friend Mark Rosney here tonight, but unfortunately, he has. He has the flu.
Is it man flu, though?
We're not sure if it's normal flu or man flu, but he did sound rather rough when I spoke to him this morning.
Rough.
are you calling our friend a dog?
No.
Big fluffy Alsatian.
Oh, I don't know. So, anyway, yes, we have... is Neil sponsored by Cadbury's?
Last Whisper. Time I looked, there wasn't.
Whisper.
Oh, very funny. Very funny.
That'll be John for you.
That's my John.
Yeah, definitely. So, as I say, we've got a few in tonight at the moment, so hopefully everyone remembers.
Yes, and Nigel has confirmed that it is him.
I thought it would be Nigel. Nice to see you on the show, Nigel, and look forward to having you on the show next week.
Have a good conversation about
this. Yes, we've also got Six Sense Paranormal on next week as well, coming all the way from Nottingham to come and join us.
I'm definitely putting it downstairs.
Yes. Oh, that reminds me. We have, as you've noticed, changed the office around, okay, made a little bit more room. And today we was going to have the
hub
downstairs in the living room, but because we were less one person, we decided to stay up here today. Yes, but next week
it was going to be very Oprah Winfrey.
It was
have our guest on the couch.
Yes, well, next week we can have our guest on the couch, can't we? So it should be fun. So tune in for that. Because Nigel's got some really interesting stuff to tell you, and not too far away from us, actually, somewhere up in the Three Peaks area, which isn't far away from us, and we used to actually go there, didn't we?
Yes, for those of the team that are on, we used to call it the
middle of nowhere. Yeah, we used to do an investigation up there.
Because they didn't want it advertised, the actual venue.
No.
Because obviously it's a working building, they didn't want loads of people turning up.
So, John, what have you been doing last time since last time we saw you?
Well, main thought for those of interest for this evening is a poltergeist phenomena.
And, okay.
Just next week, I think, a film coming out called When the Lights Go Out, and that's based on a true incident. Happened quite a few years ago in the 70s, and it was a really frightening incident for the people involved, and a council house, or I think it was, and they experienced all kinds of phenomena, and usually start at a very low level. Like scratching or something, like mice or rats.
We'll be talking about that a bit later on in the show then.
I saw the clip earlier on the week.
Yes, I'm going to be showing it.
It looks quite scary.
I will be showing it.
Yes, we can't get moaned at then because we didn't have the clip last week, did we?
No, we didn't, but we have got this one. And Neil, what have you been up to apart from bodybuilding?
Jo says she stopped in the house on Monday.
I know, I was going to mention that later because they were there at the premiere.
Yes, they're supposed to come in and tell us, aren't they?
Go on. Well,
apart from bodybuilding getting rid of poltergeists. No, I've not done that in a while, so. I'm in the middle of moving house at the moment, so I've got a lot of building work going on, and doing sort of skimming plaster and laying floors and various other things, trying to get it all ready.
I was actually looking at the screen here at the picture, and it actually looks like he's still in the bloody army.
I know it does.
It looks like a new Marine sitting there.
Especially
with that haircut.
You say their camouflage.
This time it was my choice, it wasn't their choice.
Yeah, camouflage, that's what I'm going to call you from now on.
Whispering camouflage.
Whispering camouflage. So, right, yes, Simply Joe stopped in the house on Monday because some of the Simply Ghost Night team actually went there for the premiere.
They did.
So maybe they can give us a call later and tell us how they felt while they were there. So just to reiterate, if that's the right word, pronounced right, we do have Simply Joe, we have John and Vicky and whoever else is watching from their computer. I couldn't think what it was called, John. Reiki Debs, and that's about it from what I can see. I can't see anybody else on there at the moment.
Yeah, Debs, can you...
Oh, we got quite a few watching, so...
Deb, can you let us know whose number it is you want? She went, how can I have his number? LOL.
Oh, right, okay.
I'm wondering whose number she wants.
If she means Ben, I'm terribly sorry. Right, okay. Well, what I'm going to do is now...
And Denise just popped in.
Oh, hi, Denise. Wait until our past eight. That's when he's on. Right, just for now, I'm going to do some... paranormal news that we've got, This is one that John picked out for us recently, mentioned to us last night. Do you remember the witch trials of Salem in that little town in Massachusetts?
I wasn't born then.
Yes, not personally, no.
No, I'm not talking the Salem in Oldham either. Well, apparently, there was a family called the Town Family, okay, from America, and they came to Great Yarmouth to explore their links with the town. Two of their family members from Great Yarmouth were executed as part of the Salem witch trials in 1690s. Elizabeth Hanahan, president of the Tau Family Association, with Joanne Tau and a couple of people there, they've put a plaque up in the church inside St. Nicholas Minster, saying the Tau Family from America coming to Great Yarmouth to explore their links. The two families from Great Yarmouth were executed, as I said. And the plaque says, if I can read it, William Town and Joanne Blessing were married in the church on the 25th of April, 1629, I think that is. It's quite small. See if I can get in a bit more. I'm having trouble here. Hold on. Oh, here we go. 1620, and six of their eight children were baptised there. They founded the Town Family in America, and two of their children, Rebecca and Mary, were executed during the Salem witch trials delusion in 1690. There was a lot around that, wasn't there? These witch trials. Yeah, can't get back now.
Didn't it actually say that they were exonerated a bit late?
Yeah, a bit late. They were exonerated, weren't they? Which was our Pendle witches were like the equivalent, weren't they?
Yeah,
really?
That was more or less the same time. Yeah, in fact, this last week.
A lot of hysteria, and all, weren't there? With it mainly people.
Yeah, so they made a pilgrimage from their home in California to keep the memory of the witches alive, and 37 descendant relatives jetted across the Atlantic to St. Nicholas Minster, where the plaque, which is where the plaque to the witches has been put up. So who would have thought a plaque would be put up to commemorate witches
in a church?
Technically, in a church.
Now the big question is, how many of them are actually Wiccan?
This is it. This is the thing, because it is actually the Wiccan area, isn't it? Deb said she put that in the wrong chat post. Jebby, my good lad, how are you? Long time no see. About time you've got you on the show as well.
it keeps avoiding us.
I know. Unfortunately, your friend Mark isn't with us tonight. He's got the flu. So, but it's nice to see you again.
Yeah, but I know Jebby too.
Yeah. John Hall's here, so I believe you know each other. And good evening, sir. And as I say, if you don't know, we have got Ben Hansen on later from Paranormal Files. And I'm sure if nobody knows on Facebook, then there's something wrong, because I've been a bit of a spammer.
Yeah, you have. You've been posting it literally everywhere.
So as I say, these came to. It makes me laugh, if that's the right word, now we're commemorating stuff like that. Look, we commemorated the witch trials here, haven't we, with putting the 1612 or whatever it was up on Pendle Hill, whereas back in the day it was it was hush hush and all this, that and the other, and now it's strange how we commemorate the bad. Do you know what I mean?
Well, that's what the English are good at.
Yeah,
I mean, come on. How often do we celebrate something that we did that was good?
It's
always things like that get celebrated. It's ridiculous, really, and I don't really know why the English have that mentality, but especially when you think that the witchcraft law is actually still intact.
Yeah, it is, isn't it?
Somebody in Nottingham, they still use it.
Yes.
So people can actually, you've got to be careful in Nottingham the way you work as a medium, because you can still get arrested for it. They still use it.
Yeah. Mind you, really and truthfully, when it comes to mediumship and stuff like that, there is still a bit of a
a badness about it. Look at the, you know, they want you all to be credited and all this lot, isn't it?
Which I think should happen. There should be some, and I must say this every week, there's got to be some governing body somewhere to regulate now, because the amount of people that are coming out saying that they are a medium is ridiculous. There's thousands out there, absolutely, well, more than thousands, you know. It's just growing and growing and growing.
And not to harp too much on last week's conversation, but it was only at the weekend when I was talking to a couple of mediums at the Mind, Body and Spirit show in Derby, and we just happened to come on about that incident, about that spade and that paranormal group.
Yeah.
And like I was saying, that if the government, the way they are at the moment, if they wanted to, they could ban all paranormal investigations. Well, I didn't really think about it, but with the way they feel about mediumship as well, it doesn't just cover paranormal investigations. Oh, yeah. It covers the whole lot.
Yeah,
it could, if the government was to turn around and say, bang, stop, you know, like you said, it put us back in the dark ages.
We go back to the three knocks on the door.
You'd have the secret knock on the door. I remember that when my grandmother used to do that.
The paranormal groups have really got to be careful what they're doing, and any person, not just paranormal groups.
It's really amazing, especially on Facebook.
Mm.
I mean, at one point there was a new medium popping up every day.
Yes.
It's like, where did they all come from?
Yeah.
Oh, there's hundreds of mediums on Facebook.
Yeah.
Especially as when we entered 2012.
Yes.
All of a sudden, everybody was a medium.
And a lot of them actually rate themselves, you know. Where this rating system comes from, I don't know, but, you know, you get people coming on, international medium, being voted the second best in the UK, you know, and who's actually doing the voting for that?
Well,
where's that being regulated?
Well, I gave a message the other day, and I've been abroad. Does that make me an international medium? Or do I actually have to give somebody a message in Spain?
I've no idea. I mean, I'm not international. You know, I've been all over the world, but I'm not international. I've given messages in places like Africa and Canada, and, you know, it doesn't make me international. Does it
kind of does, actually.
Apparently, it does.
Yeah. I'm not renowned internationally, though, am I? You know, so it's. I don't know.
It is strange.
It's my bowl of contention.
It's strange what people tend to call themselves.
Mm.
Yeah.
I mean, whether it's to get more business, I don't know, and just how many of them are actual
enter a correspondence course to become a medium now.
How the heck do you do that?
Well, you do it psychically, of course, don't you?
Definitely.
Yeah.
So
the answer to question two is B.
Yes. It is quite a subject.
Without asking the question.
Yeah.
It is quite a subject.
Oh, sorry, I'm one in front of you. That's question three. That's B.
Do psychic conferences are closed due to unforeseen circumstances?
Yeah, Reiki Deb said there is really cowboys in all trades. There are. But governing bodies usually place too many restrictions and usually contradict themselves, seeing too much of it in the Reiki world and dog world. But I agree there should be something done. But you get cowboys in all trades.
There should be something to prove that you are an actual medium.
Well, yeah, that. I mean, there's some sort of testing.
At least then we know it's not. When you go out to somebody that's accredited, you know you're not going to a code reader.
Yeah, exactly.
Which to be honest, is so easy to do. I mean, I even did it the other day to somebody. I was talking to him, and I mentioned it, and I went, "Is there a J name with you?" And her eyes went, whoa. And it's like, I went, see?
Yeah.
What you just did with your eyes told me you've got a J name.
Yeah.
I mean, it wouldn't take much more to find out whether it's male, female, sister, mother, whatever.
Exactly.
Give you all the information you need to, pass back.
Yeah. I mean, and that's without knowing body language. I was just looking at her, watching her face. And I said, I got a J name with you, and her eyes went, whoa, instant recognition, yeah.
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 I mean, see what I mean? And it's so easy to do.
But like Sue and Reiki said, Reiki Dev said, how do you prove it, though? We went to see Darren Brown in February. He was good, but doesn't claim to be a medium. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So well, we watched the program, didn't we? And he was actually...
Yeah.
He actually taught somebody to be a medium, and he got away with it in America on stage with their big, so-called big religious people.
Well, this is it.
He was on the programme a while back, and he outed a Liverpool medium called John Power.
Joe Power.
and he set him up, basically, didn't he?
Yeah,
he did.
So
he's basically saying he's a comforter. You know, that's what he does. He comforts people.
Mm. Yeah.
But I mean, that's kind of, that's probably a bit harsh, because I mean, I don't know Joe. I've heard about him, but I mean,
I know Joe very well.
Yeah, but if he's getting stuff that's comforting, what else can he do?
Simply, Joe said, there'll always be fake mediums for as long as there's people who fall for it, and that's basically it, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly. People are always going to fall for it because the people that go to mediums are looking for comfort.
Yeah.
They're
which is where it comes back to the government. If they were to turn around and say that, you know, they're looking for that sort of thing, and when it comes to murder victims and stuff like that. Look, I'll be honest with you, we were at an MBS this weekend, right, and this woman came up to us and she said, oh, paranormal group. And the first thing she said was, I could do with somebody like you to help me find out what actually happened to my brother. Yeah, we know he was murdered, blah, 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 blah.
Yeah, and
you know what I mean?
And she's already used the medium and took him to the spot.
It's it's, you know, and I've always said that that's not what we're there for. You know, we're not there for that sort of thing.
I mean, apart from which, if we were to say yes, she'd already told us all the information we need to con her anyway.
Precisely.
Because she just stood there and told her that...
This happened, that happened, blah, blah, blah.
They say it was one, but we know there was two.
Mm.
And then that did it. I mean, how easy would it be to follow up on that?
Sue73 said, I'm a medium, but I don't go around advertising it. I only tell the people that I felt the message is for. And it's up to them what they make of it. I've given many readings and proven right. Joe totally agrees with you, Steve. She said, I don't guess nor trick. If I don't get anything from them, I won't force it. And Nigel said, being honest is the key to being a good medium. Mm-hmm. The rest usually fall by the wayside in time.
As long as you're true to yourself and only give what you can guarantee that you're getting without trying to jump and especially as a new medium, it's easy to take that extra step that you shouldn't be, because you're reading into what you're getting and it's so easy to make that jump.
Don't get me wrong, we're not here discussing dissing anybody or whatever,
you have to be patient with it,
you know. It's just that you know, there are certain stories you hear out there, you know, and unfortunately it does, when the bad stories come out, it does reflect on the good ones, if you understand what I mean, because being at the MBS, we're there to tell people what paranormal investigations are all about, but I actually felt as though I was doing an extra job of explain that paranormal investigators aren't what they were being portrayed in the Red Tops recently. Yeah.
Well,
so if you understand what I mean, so that's what it's all about.
Was it Angela, the medium that was next to us?
Yes.
She actually asked me about it herself.
Yeah.
And we actually agreed with each other.
Yeah.
About what they should and shouldn't have done with
that. Yeah, so basically, you know, don't get me wrong, we're not here to diss anyone. You know, it's just that you hear all these bad stories, don't you? And you know for a fact it reflects on mediums, paranormal groups, you know,
and unfortunately the Red Tops don't report it straight, they like a bit of hype,
and we were talking
about that earlier.
Sensationalism. Sue's just said, no, I know, folks, I do get annoyed with those who make us true mediums look silly. This is the situation.
And what people don't understand, there's a lot of people that come or go to mediums that they sort of live their life by what they've been told.
Yeah, this is
and
it.
If they're being told any silly old nonsense, which some mediums out there will give. They'll just give it. If they can't get something through, they'll make it up.
Yeah.
You know, so they're potentially ruining people's lives.
This is it, yeah.
One particular group I went to with, it used to be with Mara, we went to another group in the Wirral, and they brought in this particular medium, I can't remember who it was, and he was giving various things out, you know, just shooting things out here and there, left, right and centre, and then someone latch onto it, and then he'd be off, and some people seemed quite impressed, and then he sort of looked over to myself, and he started going on, so I let him carry on, and then he seemed quite impressed, you know, he was getting all these hits, and I stopped him off just towards a bit the end, and he said, sorry mate, all you're saying is wrong, I just made it up for your benefit. So with that he went, oh, I'm not getting the right vibes off you, I'll have to cut you off here, and then he went straight to someone else. So you let him go up, just reel a mouse, like, you know, reeling in a fish, and obviously he just spouting a load of rubbish.
Well, they dropped themselves today, didn't they?
Yeah, they did.
Well, he did in this, but he wasn't fazed, because obviously he went straight to someone else, and then they took it all on, you know, whether he took it off serious or not. Oh, yeah, oh, so-and-so. Then he went to someone else. But from his point of view, he had a successful evening, but can I stop him short or let him go on and see how much rubbish he comes out with? And in this particular case, he did come out with a load of rubbish. And
well, yeah, Sue's just come back here and said, can you also make the point that... stop moving. If it be politically correct, incorrect, I would never charge anyone for anything. I give them via reading. It's against my principles. How can I charge for what God has given me? And then she apologised if she offended anybody. No, don't worry. So that this is what this show's about. It's for people to get their point across. Give us their opinion. If others disagree, then they're obviously quite welcome to give their opinion. Then give us some controversy.
Simply Joe said, "Good for you, Sue," and I agree with that. And no, you're not offending anyone. And Reiki Deb said, because Sue, a lot of people don't appreciate things when they are free. You have a gift, even if it's only a small donation.
Yeah,
which I agree.
It's true. I mean, we've been doing this 7 years. Yeah, me and you. So.
Yeah.
And how many groups along the way have we known that actually charge for doing a house rescue? We've come across quite a few of those.
We have quite, you know, people have come to us and said, do you charge? And we've said no, and they said, oh, we had one group in and they charged us.
Yeah. Well, I've heard of that as well. Various people, one particular house we went to in Speak, they were having all kinds of problems. Now, just before we went there, the lady's house it was, she said a certain medium come round, and then she went round the house, various parts, and asked what happened here, what happened there, and she'd done some incantations or down to deep channeling or whatever she'd done, and said, oh, the house is cleared now, and then she went on to make a charge, and I can't remember what she actually charged her. Of course, whatever was still there, it was still there. When we went round, it was still pretty active. Poltergeist, and going back to that, and an apparition I've seen on the stairs by the householder, and it was just a pair of legs, just legs, nothing else. And right up on the top room, there was a sort of luminous sort of thing seen. We stayed there the whole evening, and there was a few incidents, but overall nothing happened, but it was a strange place. All right.
Right, well, it's time for us to call our special guest.
It is.
So I'm going to leave you with this for 32 seconds while I give him a call. We'll see you straight after this.
Oh my God!
There's a flying saucer. I'm getting a series of lights right there.
Oh my God!
What the heck is happening?
Oh.
Right, good evening. We're back, ladies and gentlemen. And, what is that?
There's somebody at the door.
There's somebody at the door.
Well, you take my mic down.
Sorry about that.
Is it your end, Ben?
Yeah, that's my doorbell here.
Oh, right. Do you want to go and get it? Yeah,
there was me thinking
no,
it was married.
It's all right. We got somebody to get it.
Well, good evening, Ben. How are you? Or rather, afternoon.
Good. How are you? Though?
Not too bad. Thank you for coming on the show.
You're welcome. Thank you for having me.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce you to Mr. Ben Hansen. He is the guy from Fact or Faked Paranormal Files, the show that has been best described as Mythbusters meets Destination Truth. And so if you want to ask him a question, he's here to do so. So, Ben, we're actually on the second series here, but I did manage to see some of the third series. But what have you actually been up to of late?
Well, you guys are behind.
Typical.
We've aired the whole third series here in the U.S., and I think Canada was just starting. They're a little bit behind us. Australia is starting theirs this past week, I think. So, we finished filming back in June, and I've been just traveling around the country to different ghost hunting events, UFO sky watches, giving lectures, doing appearances and all that stuff, staying really busy.
Right. So, but just to go back a bit, can you just briefly tell us a bit about the show for those that haven't quite found the Sci-Fi Channel over here?
If they haven't found it, they
sure.
Tell it off.
Well, we started filming. I guess it was 2010, and basically the show. I don't produce the show, but I was able to be on the ground level of a lot of the conception of it. And, you know, I was looking around and seeing kind of what else was on TV. And I decided that, you know, a lot of these shows are observation based,
mm-hmm.
you know, which is fine. But what that means is that they start out with a location that is allegedly haunted, and then they'll go and just wait for things to happen. And, you know, I felt like because of my kind of background in law enforcement investigations and all that, that it would make sense to maybe start with the evidence that you already have on hand.
Mm.
And so that kind of evolved into us doing experiments. You know, you guys, I'm sure, have the show Mythbusters.
Yeah.
And, you know, so we became kind of the Mythbusters of the paranormal, and we didn't set out to debunk things. I like to think of it more of as verifying different cases. So we're able to take a look at something and look at the most reasonable or simple explanation first. And if that isn't satisfying, then, you know, we look at the paranormal.
Right. We've had a question for you from Jebby.
Can I jump in just before?
Oh, go on then, before we ask the question.
I was wondering whether, for myself, I was wondering whether you actually did it, any investigations like this while you were still in the FBI. And like Sue was just about to say, it's a bit of a switch from the FBI to paranormal investigating. Why the switch?
yeah, it is. It's quite a change. There's more... more that is, I guess, pertinent than you would think, though. I can't talk about any specific cases that I did while I was there because I'm not sure if they've, you know, gone to court yet. And I'm really, you know, there are a lot of more national security stuff. But I can tell you it's not your routine type of a case the FBI would get involved in. However, it is public record that the FBI has done investigations into, for example, cattle mutilations
mm-hmm.
In the 70s because of the outbreak. They were also involved or requested to be involved in flying saucer crashes. You know, we have the Hoover documents from that.
Yeah.
So, you know, every now and then the agency, something crosses over, anything that has to do with national security, you know, they would be interested in that. But as far as making that transition, I always, you know, loved both worlds. I loved Working in public service, it's very intrinsically satisfying to put criminals behind bars. At the same time, I've always had this kind of passion for paranormal, but unfortunately, unless you're on TV or writing books about it, you really can't get paid for it. I grew up, you know, in high school and things watching, you know, like the X-Files. So I thought, well, why can't I have the best of both worlds? And I did leave the door open when I left law enforcement to go back there.
Yeah.
Because I love it. But this is different. You know, I, for example, the boss that I have now is the audience. And it really doesn't feel like work a lot of the time. Right. So.
Well, I don't know whether you're actually on our webpage and seeing the chat room at all. But if you are, there's a lot of swooning going on. I must admit.
Log in there and I'll take a look at it. What's the address?
It's ktpf.co.uk.
And ktpf.co.uk.
Okay. And when you get in there, there's once you get on the page, there should be a big blue button that says KTPF show. Just click that and you'll see the chat room there.
Unfortunately,
I wouldn't go into the filming bit because otherwise you'll get a lot of interference over the Skype.
You have to keep that bit quiet.
See the chat room bit and notice how the women have come on alive. make the most of it, girls. Next week you've got a bald 50-year-old with middle-aged Fred.
One of our people in the chat room has asked about Project Blue Book.
Do you know anything? Yeah. What is Project Blue Book?
Well, Project Blue Book was the United States Air Force's official investigation into the UFO phenomena. It started out with it was first called Project Grudge, slips my mind. They called it two things before it was Blue Book, and really, though, what we understand about it now, it was kind of a public front,
mm-hmm.
because the real cases of the concerning UFO cases that concern national security didn't go to Project Blue Book. They went directly to another arm of the Air Force, and they kept it up till I think it was 67 or 69, and it was officially closed because even though they had about 5% of the cases they couldn't explain, those cases were not a threat to national security. It's kind of like the parallel program that the MOD has there with Nick Pope, is a famous UFO researcher who was kind of the bookkeeper for the files there as well.
Right. Well, you've got a crack team with you, as I say, you've got Bill Murphy who's your lead scientist.
Uh-huh.
Effects specialist Larry Coughlin, is that?
What?
How do you pronounce his name?
Coughlin.
Coughlin.
Like coughing.
Right, and you got JL DePardo with you, journalist who was actually with Joshua Gates in one of his monster shows. Was it Monster Hunter? Destination Truth.
Destination Truth, I think it was.
Yeah. So you stole him from her, or her from him?
We had a duel, and I won.
I was kind of going to ask about that. I mean, we know JL from Destination Truth. The rest of your team are pretty much unknown to us in the UK.
Yeah.
Before your series started, how did you go about actually choosing your team?
Well, the team has even changed beyond that. You'll see. You've got season two. 2.5 and 3, we have a new photographer and a new tech guy, but the original team that you're seeing now, I had a team formed of 6 people, and most of them, about half of them are the ones. Larry and Austin were with me from the beginning. Bill, I met him, you know, a year or so before the show started,
mm-hmm.
and he's kind of really the top of his game, and his focus primarily is ghost hunting and ghost technology. The guy is like, he's like the professor on Gilligan's Island. He knows everything.
Oh, dear. But we do enjoy the show over here in the UK, and we hope you do some more.
Yeah, I think it's is it Letitia that's your new photographer?
Lanisha?
Is it Lanisha
Cole?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, we've got Lanisha Cole and Austin on here. Yeah. So
over the three series, which would you say to you was the most interesting one you did?
You know, I get asked that a lot, and probably it won't air there for a while, but we did a case in the UK. And I forget the name of the town, but it was close to Stratford-upon-Avon.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a case of she's an American woman who lives in the UK, and she was in her bed and had some classic kind of abduction.
We saw it last night.
Yeah, we actually watched that one last night.
Like I said, we managed to be able to get season three.
Yes, we cheated and downloaded season three from America.
that was a good episode.
Yeah, and what's most compelling is not, I mean, we were able to replicate, I don't want to give it away for those who haven't seen it, but, you know, pretty much the how she could have done it if she would have hoaxed it, but this is a very, very credible family, and the interviews indicated to me that she really had at least what she perceived as a that experience, and she doesn't say it's alien, but she appears to have, you know, just kind of disappeared in her bed, in the mattress, kind of the sheets dissolve for 13 minutes, and then the figure reforms, and, you know, like she'd never been gone. So it really baffles me. She's willing to come out now in public. She's going to be speaking with me probably in the big conference coming up in Edinburgh in August of next year. So that was a great case.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah, it is, I was actually interested. It was quite funny because when the case came up, the first thing I said to Sue was what you actually did to replicate it.
Yeah. Is there anything that you've, out of all your shows you've done, what would you say the percentage was that you're actually finding between fake and truth?
Well, you know, in the first season, it seemed like we were about half and half.
Mm.
And then in the second season and third, I don't know if we just got better or if we were seeing more hoaxes.
It's good when you can actually find the hoax. You know, that's the old good thing about it, really. And, you know, it's good when you find the truth as well. But the fact, like, we have programs over here and it's all about ghost hunting. Yeah, we ourselves are a paranormal group over here, and it's all about the ghost hunting. And we see these shows. One actually crossed the Atlantic and came over to you, and yours have done the same this way. But it's all about going to see the ghost hunting, and they normally do stuff and what have you. But yours is coming from a different angle. You're going in cold and seeing what's happening and what's supposed to be happening. You're taking the stuff off of where I assume YouTube and seeing all the vile footage that's out on the internet, and that's how you get your series going, basically. And it's fantastic. Yeah. It's a good concept, to be honest with you.
I enjoyed the one I watched the other night on the battleship.
On the battleship.
Yeah, where the camera got damaged.
That
was cool.
Yeah, that was good.
Let me tell you. That, if you ever get a chance to go there, that's one of the most active places I've ever been.
Wow.
Even between filming, when our cameras weren't rolling, we had these big serving metal trays, you know, that they have in the kitchens with the lids. And, you know, we had one of those. I wasn't making fun of the ghost. I was just talking about how, you know, maybe he had fallen down this certain well, and supposedly a soldier had died there, and all of a sudden one of these lids picked up and slammed back down right behind me.
Mm.
You know, and that was right before our camera was destroyed.
Wow.
So something was not very happy there.
I bet. So I'd love to work with you.
I actually like that because we hear some of the stuff that you don't see on camera.
Yeah, so I'd love it if you ever come over to here and you could work with us.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if any of our listeners have served in the Navy at all, but all their tops have lips, so nothing can actually fall off. And that's where the camera was that got damaged and ended up bouncing on the floor.
Yeah.
I was looking at Jay's face. She was not happy with that that camera went.
But
where are you guys located?
Oh, yeah, pardon? Sorry.
Where in the UK are you located?
We are actually in Manchester in the UK.
Ah, I love Manchester.
Yeah, so we're there, even though from our voice, we're not Mancunians, we actually come from down Kent way, but we live in Manchester now, and we've been part of a paranormal group for nearly seven years now. We've been doing paranormal investigating.
Yeah, we've had our own team for 6 years.
Yeah, we've had our own team for 6 years, so, and we're not a company, we're a not-for-profit group. So, you know, because there are companies here that go out and do their bit. We do a similar sort
of thing.
Really? Yeah, yeah.
You have groups that charge for their services?
Yeah, when I say charge, I don't mean like what you do, you know, and seeing going out and seeing whether there's anything going on. What I mean is we would go to a place like a museum or something and we'd hire it for the evening and then we'd take... you know, we'd charge the public to come on that investigation with us.
Oh, gotcha.
And show them what a paranormal investigation's like, you know.
Yeah.
And get them involved and let them be a paranormal investigator for the evening, you know, and they do all the experiments and stuff like that, you know.
I thought you were talking about charging like Ghostbusters, like you guys have proton packs.
Oh, no. We do private ones, I must admit, but we never charge for that at all.
Yeah, we never charge
for
helping
people. No, that's a service we do that we don't charge for. Now,
but I'm reading here online.
Having said that, if you do have a spare proton pack, I would love one.
Yeah, an IR camera would be really nice. But are you reading all the comments in the chat room?
Yeah. I see something about a sexy voice, a nice bum, and then ask him to say hi to us ladies. So hi, ladies.
Oh dear, I don't know. There was one there I just saw. Let's see if I can go back up. There was some questions there. Are there any investigations that don't make it on the show, they're asking? Jebby wants to know.
Yeah, there's... Well, not full cases, no. I mean, once we actually go out and film, it would be too expensive for them just to scrap something.
Yeah.
We have some that aren't our favorites. Right. Okay. You know, where an investigation, like the experiments didn't turn out whether we liked or nothing happened in the night investigation. So you'll see on those episodes, you'll have like maybe 3/4 of the time devoted to the other case, okay. And then a little blurb about the one that we didn't like.
Yeah, I did notice that.
I have another one for you from Mark. He popped on Skype and left me a message for you. He said... what is your opinion on orbs? Do you feel it is the first stage of spirit forming at all? Or do you think something else?
Well, orbs are an interesting thing because I think there's a tendency for people to, at least here in the U.S., they're very anti-orb. And they will say when they take a picture, all orbs are either, you know, moisture or dust. And I don't think it's that simple. I think when you have a photograph and you look at the photo later, yes, the majority by far, I believe, are some artifact, you know, on the lens of the camera. However, there have been many cases where, you know, you can visually see the orb, and it's not just related to ghost hunting, but we label orbs also with things that have to do with UFOs, with interdimensional being stuff. You know, so it's really kind of hard to classify, but I've known very, very credible people tell me stories of intelligent orbs of light that will actually follow them or have been in the vicinity of cattle or horse mutilations, you know, where the animal looks like literally it's exploded, orbs that are seen around crop circles. You know, so it's kind of hard to say what it is, but it does seem that at least it might have something to do with, you know, spirits and the ghost hunting as well.
Okay, we have another question.
I have another question for you. One's actually done in hope, I think. Debbie wants Chilan's phone number. and Sherba said, how many days do you actually film your investigation over to get the stuff for the program?
Well, if we film domestically here in the U.S., we film probably, we have, you know, two cases per episode, and each of those cases, you know, takes up, when you take the commercials out, pretty much only 17 minutes of film, but each of that 17 minutes is filmed over roughly 4 days in the field and 2 days in the office. So, you know, you're looking probably at about, with all the different cameras and stuff, about 70 hours of film whittled down to 17 minutes.
Wow.
Yeah, that's what a lot of people don't realize.
Yeah.
Especially, it's the same with the show, the big show that was on over here. We actually worked it out that there was only about 15 minutes of actual investigation on the show, and that was filmed over 2 or 3 days.
Well, you got another question for you. I've got to try and get, I haven't got much time left with you, but
okay.
Dazzy from Six Sense said, what would you say is your best paranormal experience, maybe on the show, but you've had a lifelong fascination with the paranormal, so what is your best experience you've had?
Well, I'll give you two. The best UFO experience I've had is I witnessed, actually here where I grew up, you know, off the back porch with my father in Utah, and we saw an object hovering. It disappeared, moved a mile to the right. It was red and very dimly lit, and then it flew over our house and covered 12 miles in about 4 seconds. It was incredible, and I've seen a couple objects doing incredible things. With ghost hunting, you know, there's been a few. The first time I saw object manipulation, it blew me away, and that was in a cemetery in Indiana where I was hearing something like it was pacing me, and I would hear leaves crunch every time I took a step, and I took out my flashlight or torch, looked on the ground, and I saw a pile of leaves depressing in the shape of a footprint.
Wow.
So that was pretty crazy. And I've seen other objects moving, you know, since that time.
Fantastic.
Of all the questions, this is probably one you've been asked quite a lot. Given the choice, where would you like to investigate?
Mm. Well, there's a lot of cool places. You know, going back to the UK, we still have not done Loch Ness Monster. we have not done Rendlesham Forest, which is the, you know, the U.S. Forest base, and that whole incident, it's like your Roswell.
Yeah.
You know, there's a couple of weird crypto, you know, animals that I would really like to do here in the U.S. as well. I'd like to go on probably like a week or two Sasquatch hunt. That would be really fun.
Right, yeah. That reminds me. Yeah. Somebody asked me a question about that on Facebook. Yeah. Something about the Beast of Bodmin Moor. You had a theory for that. Where did you actually get it from? Do you know anything about that?
Well, we had the which beast? We filmed an episode on the Beast of Dartmoor.
Yeah, the Beast of Dartmoor. Somebody asked me a question on how you came to your theory that it was... I can't remember what the question was. I'm trying to find it quick. About your theory, how did you come to... Oh, a cross between something or other? I can't remember what the answer was, to be honest with you. But you came across something.
I can't honestly remember which person's opinion aired in that episode either, but I do think that it was kind of ironic that the filmographer didn't have the original footage, so we couldn't check it for CGI. But
right.
If that film was CGI, it was pretty good. I mean, the animal flowed quite well. And I find it improbable that there was an actual... There are black lions, but I find that improbable. There's one running around there. But what I did find very interesting was the sheep carcasses and things we found with our tracker with us. You guys aren't supposed to have, you know, like wild lions and... tigers running around there.
It's down to the fact that a few years ago, back in the 70s, licensing laws came in that you couldn't hold the cats and what have you, as a personal pets.
Yeah, you could only keep them for 2 years. Yeah. And then they had
so
to
what happened was, instead of, if you couldn't, they couldn't put them in zoos, they were just letting them free across the land, and that's where all the stories come from.
Yeah, we do have quite a few leopards and pumas and in this country running around.
Yeah.
Well, so they must be hiding well and breeding, because you'd think you'd hear stories of them, like, taking children out of homes or something.
This is it.
No, I think that was a fox.
So, Jebby said it was a cross between a wild boar and something else that the theory was or something. I didn't see that episode, unfortunately, so I can't comment on it, I'm afraid. But anyway, it's been great talking to you. But just quickly, you're coming to the UK next year, aren't you?
That's the plan. There's a huge conference, the Spirits, Shadows, and I think Seekers, I think, is the official title, conference. And it's in August. I don't have the exact dates. It's up on my website right now, but huge. I mean, we're talking like 50 different speakers, a lot from the U.S., a lot from the U.K., and I would love to take some extra time there. We're going to be doing like UFO sky watches. I think I'm leading a ghost hunt. I would love to just kind of spend some more time in the U.K. and actually go around and hang out with some of your groups and, you know, have a lot of fun.
That would be great. You'll have to contact us. The seminar is called the Spirits, Shadows and Secrets International Symposium, and it's part of the Edinburgh Fringe on August the 19th to the 25th next year. We have our medium here with us who wants to ask you a quick question, if you don't mind.
Okay.
Hi, Ben. Neil.
Hi, Ben.
How's it going?
How are you doing? Okay. I watch your program religious, by the way. I actually tape every episode.
Well, thank you.
It was just a quick question, really. What is your take, or what is your belief on mediums?
I definitely believe that there are people who have gifts. I've run into a lot of them that if they had a gift, they seem to be more concerned with, I don't know. I'm thinking of one or two people in particular who will make predictions and things that it seems like they're just kind of randomly doing it for the financial gain. But it's sad, because I think there are people who have a really a good, you know, a benefit to not only ghost investigations, but to kind of giving people insight on their lives. And I completely believe in it.
Yeah, we had this discussion just before you come on the show, and I just wanted your version. It's very similar as what we were talking about, actually. So, thanks for that.
Well, you know, and Syfy, as of yet, they have not gone down that road, and I've asked them why. I don't know. They seem to feel that their viewers, you know, that it's a different genre, it's a different world, that the psychics. They had a show here about a psychic and her family, and it kind of bombed. And I don't know if they're going to go down that road again, but we've always, you know, kind of encourage them to look more into that possibility.
Super.
Yeah, well, Ben, you know where we are, and hopefully you'll be coming on the show before you come to the UK and give us another interview. That would be great if you could.
Oh, I'd love to. You guys are a lot of fun. And let me say, when I was first in the UK, we took some time in downtown London, and we went dancing and things, and it's, I was pleasantly surprised. The guys are awesome, the blokes are fun, but the women, you have some very, very attractive women that I was not expecting.
Have you been reading the comments in the chat room as well? One woman said, it's amazing how the men are asking intelligent questions and the women are just commenting.
Right.
So maybe you could quick quickly type something and say hello to them when you've got 5 minutes.
Sure. You know,
while you're in Edinburgh, if you're going to do a ghost hunt, you want to get yourself down to the vaults. You can do the tour during the day.
Yeah, Edinburgh vaults. You can do them during the day if you get a
chance. Yes. We went to the it was the Mary's Close.
Yes.
Tour and they had some really cool stories, but what I wanted to do was the one across by the church where they have all these scratches and attacks. You know, that's where I wanted to go, and we almost had an episode there. And we had this cool idea. We were going to test it out because most of the attacks reportedly happen when the people go back to their hotels.
Mm-hmm.
And so we were gonna set some bait somebody like make Jael do it. And hotel.
Well, if you want to have a look at our website, it's the UK Shadow Seekers, which is shadowseekers.co.uk, and see what you think. And as I say, if you ever feel like popping over and coming up and seeing us in good old Manchester, wet Manchester.
Yeah, and if you ever need assistance, there's us, and there's at least one group on the chat room that would be more than willing to give you a hand.
Yeah.
Let's plan on it. Let's meet up and we'll do a meet up somewhere, because you know the times that I've been over there, you guys only had the first season, and we were trying to organize a meet up for followers of the show, but we didn't know where to go, no one to organize. So if you guys want to do that, and we can organize a hunt, you know, ghost hunt or something before or after the conference, and let's get everyone involved.
That'd be fantastic, Ben. All right, I'll look forward to that. So, okay.
Well, thank you so much. Oh, one thing I was going to say, back on the subject of the women, is that you guys, the ladies there, I lived in Australia for a year, and it's the same way there. Compared to Americans, it really annoys me the American women wear so much makeup. And you know when you see an attractive English woman or Australian, they're attractive because they don't have makeup, and you know that's how they naturally are. And so I don't know if that has anything to do with anything I've been talking about, but...
I haven't got any makeup on at the moment.
You could actually look at women in a fact or
faked
way there, couldn't you?
Yeah.
Hey, what is fact and what is faked about this woman? We could have a game with it.
Well, if you happen to be watching Jerry Springer, that's probably good as a man.
Well, thank you again, Ben. It's been fantastic. And as I say, I'd love to get you on again for another interview sometime next year or later on in the year. Yeah.
And going back to the meetup, if you can give us an area of time where you're going to be in the country, and we can see what we can do for you.
Sounds good. Let's keep in touch.
Yeah, do that, Ben. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, right, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, that was Mr. Ben Hansen.
Oh, my God.
There's a flying saucer. I'm getting a series of lights right there.
Oh, my God.
What the heck is happening?
Yeah, well, we're back and all flustered. How are we, ladies?
there were so many oohs on that chat room. I thought I was hearing ghosts.
So what do you reckon? Do you fancy a meet up with Ben sometime next year?
He wants a venue and then a ghost hunt.
Yeah, sounds good.
I'm sure we can work out something.
Fantastic. Well, you've heard it here first on the KTPF Community Show. Woohoo!
Rosie's being a hussy.
Oh, damn straight, daft question. oh, my
Sue,
God.
Get yourself a hot cup of sweet tea, love. Our blood pressure's gone through the roof.
Can the people give me their opinions on incubus, please? I've seen one a few years ago hiding under a table. It was in the form of a small hairy creature. Now, Danny, 123, are you the guy that's from Sixth Sense? No, you're not. You're somebody else. Do you know anything about incubuses, Neil?
An incubus is it's regarded as it's in demonology, basically. I mean, I'm probably the wrong guy to give you a description of this because I don't believe in demons, obviously. But an incubus is supposed to be a demon that would take the form of, say, a lady or a woman, and would encourage men to have sex with it, obviously. but
and I suppose a succubus is the opposite.
But where'd you go with the belief of that? You know, there's many different things out there that could still take different forms. You know, different. You know, you've got shapeshifters out there. For a start, I used to say it wasn't a shapeshifter. I used to say it wasn't something else. You know.
Yeah.
But in demonology, that's sort of a roundabout of what it's supposed to be.
And it could be either the same or both. It could be one of the same thing, either male or female.
Yeah,
transforms to whatever person.
I think
happens to attack. You know,
succubus incubus is supposed to be the same thing, and
it's supposed to be the flip of the coin, but it's generated around the same energy, really. There's no difference apart from it take the shape of a man or a woman. But it's demonology. It's an ology, you know. So it's not. In my opinion, no, they don't exist. But other people's opinions obviously would say they do.
I hope that's of some help to you, Danny. What's we got?
Danny, 1, 2, 3. Yeah. We was doing a ghost hunt, and there was about 20 of us, but only me and about 4 others seen it. Whereabouts was that then, Danny?
Yeah, Sheba said it's a transgender ghost.
Transgender ghost.
You could put it that way, yeah.
I've
you could
just
say it was a transvestite ghost, you know, but it's yeah.
I've just thanked Ben on Skype via text to say thank you for being on the show, and he's just said you're welcome. You guys are a lot of fun. So there you go, guys. He's really enjoyed all your comments on there. So, Denise, you've heard your Ben, so you don't need to worry now. Good night, Denise. I know you got to get up early.
Yeah, good night, Denise.
Okay, let's see. What else have we got here? Nigel says, I've encountered an old hag, very, very similar. Perhaps he can tell us more about that next week. We've got Dazzy something or other, I saw just there, from Sixth Sense. I think he's coming on next week with the guys from the rest of the guys from Sixth Sense. Am I right, Dazzy? Yeah. Darren? He enjoyed the interview, really exciting. I've got messages coming in over there. See what else I've got here.
John, doesn't the old hag come into folklore?
Does that come into folklore, John?
Yeah, people have experienced this either as again male, or the female, and usually in a dream state. The old hag, significant in Scandinavia, apparently, was if you experience this sort of thing, from what I've been told, it's like extreme pressure on your chest when you're sleeping of a night, yeah, and you experience sexual dreams.
So very similar to the incubus, succubus.
Almost the same thing. Depends on your perspective, you know. Recently it'd be sort of aliens entering the room.
I'm not sure whether nearly encountered a sexy ghost last time we was at Drakelow Tunnels. Either that or a dog having a good sniff.
I remember that bit. Yeah.
Yeah, we had
rude parts touched.
Yes, we were standing in a dark tunnel all on our own, and I'm actually inclined to think it was a dog.
Well, I did actually ask it to do it again, but it wouldn't.
So. Oh. You sure it wasn't one of the Simply there, Ghost girls?
Joe, you wasn't with Neil, was you?
I'm pretty sure it wasn't one of them. But I think they've all calmed down a bit now.
A deep breath.
Probably sighing over him.
They'll all be back into the 50 Shades tonight.
Yes. Somebody put on their... all the girls have gone to 50 Shades.
Rose is saying she can hear me and you, but not Neil and John. So can you speak up, gentlemen?
Mine's on.
Yeah. Okay, check it out now.
Can you hear them now?
Can you hear us now? Can you hear us out there? Is there anybody there?
Yes, okay.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
I don't know if anybody
you
actually...
You need them closer to your gob.
I don't know if actually...
Whispering.
I don't know if anybody actually knows the answer to this, but Ghost Rider said, is it true that Draco was named due to dragons?
That's... I think that's...
Is that?
Yeah, that is. So, yeah, with
I'll
that...
I'll have to have a look at the...
significant name on it, yeah, the Draco. Yeah.
Oh, is it? Mm. Oh, I
didn't
know that. Well,
there you go.
The low's probably at the tumulus as well. Ancient site, a burial site.
Mm.
Yeah, because I know at the on the top of the hill at Drakelow, there's a Iron Age burial mound at the top.
Burial mound, yeah. Well, that's probably a link the two there, yeah.
Right. Well, what were we
And I think we've got somebody visiting us.
Have we?
Yes.
Yeah, I heard that as well.
Yeah.
There was a knock and then
I thought something was thrown then.
Yeah,
sound like something.
Well, Roxy's downstairs.
She's probably thrown a bone or something.
Well, we're going to have a quick break and we're going to go into the
events.
We'll come back to the paranormal news in a bit. So.
We've got all the news right here. Don't go away.
Yeah, we'll be back in a moment. So we'll see you in a bit. Fed up of wading through the activities and events that other advertisers include? Find just what you're looking for at ParanormalEventsForYou.com, your one-stop paranormal directory.
And on the 15th of the 9th, Dark Hauntings Investigations are off to Cottesmore House Retreat in the New Forest. Also on the 15th, Lost Soul Seekers UK are off to Clitheroe Castle Museum in Clitheroe. And on the 16th of the 9th, an evening with Derek Okora at the Envy Bar Nightclub in Liverpool. And on the 21st of the 9th, there's a psychic night at the Park Inn in Harlow. Also on the 21st, Night Vision Paranormal Ghost Hunt, Sleepover and Barbecue at Harwich Redoubt Fort, Harwich. And again on the 21st of the 9th, there's a Ghost Hunt with Sixth Sense Paranormal at the Galleries of Justice in Nottingham. On the 22nd of the 9th, Spirit Watch events are at the Bell Inn in Nottingham. And lastly, but no means least, on the 29th of the 9th, Night Vision Paranormal are going to Langard Fort in Felixstowe. And for information on these events and many more, go to ParanormalEventsForYou.com.
So check out the one-stop paranormal directory for more investigations and events available now. ParanormalEventsForYou.com also offers banner advertising for only £10 per year. See our website for more details. ParanormalEventsForYou.com, your one-stop paranormal directory.
What's wrong with the old place?
Where do you want me to start?
I liked it.
Good. You can stay there.
Very funny.
Ta-da!
To the new house. Castlefield Woods. Been in there.
So?
It's right mysterious.
I don't like this house. It gives me the creeps. Dad?
Yes, love?
Did you just move my stuff?
Oh, Sally's got it into her head that we're not alone.
What do you mean?
That we've got a ghost, the daft cow. What was that?
Bloody hell, do you think you're playing at?
It wouldn't be the first time she's played tricks, would it?
This were different.
Ow.
It just were.
No.
and that's final.
I'm worried about our Sally.
Why are you crying?
So what's your interest in all this anyway?
A teacher's concern for a pupil. Sally's a very special girl.
I've still got the lights on. Get rid of it, Father.
From what you've told me, that would require an exorcism.
I'm all evil. Deliver us, O Lord.
Sudden and unprovided death.
Hasten to our call to help.
Of the Christian faith, command you! The majestic Christ commands you!
The majestic Christ commands you!
The majestic Christ commands you!
The majestic Christ commands you!
You're still here, aren't you?
Talk radio.
Just thought I'd throw that in. Welcome back.
Joe's come on here and said Draco means Dragon's Mountain, Anglo-Saxon.
Yes.
Right, okay, you've just seen a trial there from the up-and-coming film, When the Lights Go Out, which I'm looking forward to. The Simply Ghost team, most of them went to see it and stayed at the house because I think it was premiered at the house last week, last Monday night, with Richard Felix, I think, and Chris Conway because they were sitting on the stairs.
I'm going to apologise right now.
Oh, he's going to... I've muted him, but he'll probably still hear him blow his nose. Well, anyway, so we're talking about poltergeists. Now... We're talking about poltergeist phenomena and activities. And basically, John is going to tell us a bit about this and other stuff. And we also have Neil, who has actually done exorcisms and stuff like that. So goes in quite well.
And Ghost Rider just asked our guest the viewer of the Enfield poltergeist.
Right. Well, yeah, so... Do you want to start with that question?
The Enfield poltergeist, yeah, I have heard of it. It's probably one of the most famous cases to be covered. It was spoofed by BBC in a programme called Ghost Watch, which was people took as a real event. Well, in fact, it was staged. And I think most haunted copied most of the ideas and copied the entire format. But to a lesser extent, the Enfield poltergeist had practically everything, the whole repertoire of poltergeist activity, beginning with very low level scratching and something like rats or mice, and then becoming more active. It was investigated by a chap called Morris Gross from the SPI. Who recorded the girl involved, vocal cords changed to the voice of an old man who apparently said he'd come back from the graveyard and he died in the chair in the house. But there was just some of the activity going on there described as seen by the police officers who attended, and Daily Mirror journalist who took several photographs of really strange activity, but there's all stills that appear to show one of the girls, Janet I think her name was, actually flying through the air from a bed and landing on a set of drawers or with a radio on top. Of course, all this could be staged because at various points they appeared to play up to the ghost itself by imitating it, you know, banging on pipes and making noises, but the real activity centred around the focus, which was a girl called Jane, I think it was, or Janet. There was people seeing the stuff flying around the house, coming out the windows. They had stuff, material teleported from one side, from bricks and stuff. Stuff's thrown. One particular episode, of the grate was ripped out of the fireplace. Things were moving, and chairs all piled up. Just so many numerous incidents. The usual puddles of water appearing, and stacking of material.
But was it actually true, or was it really faked? Because later on in life, there was a program where they said they made it all up.
I think all of it was true myself, from my point of view.
Do you think they just didn't want all the press hype?
Harassment.
Yeah. Poltergeist, my name is means noisy ghost.
Yeah.
But there's a line of thought that it's not spirit or ghost at all. It's kinetic.
Yeah, it's the chap who made the film, when the lights go down, he reckons it's generated by inner turmoil from the family itself, and focuses on one particular person. Or alternatively, people think yeah, it's psychokinetic, generated by the person involved, which is some sort of inner energy we can externalise through pressure. It has to come out some way, and that's one particular way it comes out. Alternatively, it's a separate entity working on this, using this energy to cause all these mischievous activities. Very rarely hurts people, so I've been told. But on occasions it does. There was stuff flying around the room, and scratches appearing on people. One particular episode was when the people was in the USA. People, Eleanor, I think, I can't remember her name, but she had loads of scratches all over her body and her hands and her face, and that was put down to the poltergeist. The recent film it's currently set in the 70s. And it's supposed to reflect what's going on in today's particular society. With all, you know, in the 70s, you had the strikes and the discontent, and that's supposed to be an echo of today's society. What's going on?
So that was basically the Enfield Poltergeist. That's in it's Essex, isn't it? Well, no, it's in London.
It's London, yeah.
London. Yeah. Right, okay. So the one that's coming out now is actually in...
That's right, parts of London did go into Essex.
But the one that's out now that's coming out as a film is talking about the one in Pontefract.
Pontefract.
Right, and what is it about this one, do you know?
This one that has appeared, it got very, very similar things happened all over again, but it appeared to, again, the girl was the main focus of the activity, and the entity or whatever it was appeared as a black monk. That's what it appeared, sort of a, how would you say, all the focus of the energy seemed to make it become that, when people seen it. But it did scared the people more than hurting them again, but it left such a mess over the house, that the person's house it was, she hated it, hated cleaning up after it. That's what was reported.
Yeah.
And used to leave jam scrawled over everywhere, and absolutely wreck everything.
Right, and the we all know that the Ghost Watch one was actually a fake, even though. It was based on the Enfield one.
Yeah. Andy, we're talking about Poltergeist.
You've missed Ben Hansen from Fact or Fate, Paranormal Files, but you can read it, listen to it on the radio replay.
Yeah. He missed it. He missed all the ladies swooning.
Yeah. Ben Hansen.
Do we need to put them in therapy, or are we dealing with spirits here?
That's a good question, isn't it?
Is it a bit of both?
When I turned 11, I actually had poltergeist activity follow me around, and it absolutely petrified my mother. We spoke about this before. It would empty kitchen cupboards out. It would pile things on the middle of the floor, and within seconds it would all be put back again. There'd be mist forming. You know, my mother would get up in the night and there'd be mist coming up the stairs after her, and she'd jump in bed with me, out of all people, which scared the bejeeves out of me. You know, mum's lying in bed next to you. But over my experience, I've dealt with a lot of poltergeist phenomena, and it's very testing. I don't believe it's kinetic, because I've made contact with them, I've spoken to them, I've made physical contact with poltergeist phenomena. They do have a voice, they do talk. One experience I had in a hotel once, I had a cup and saucer thrown at me, missed my head by inches, landed on the wall.
Yeah.
And I actually said to it, "Is that the best you can do?" And then it threw the spoon. but it does generate, and somebody just said something on there.
That's what you get for teasing.
I think it was Nigel.
Yeah.
Teenagers generate intense energy. Now, most of the poltergeist phenomena that I've been to, and a lot of the exorcism work that I did, was generated around teenagers because of the hormonal differences in their body. They do generate more activity towards spiritual phenomena, and they do open gateways, if you like, and they do become big targets. You know, it's like children at a very young age, they are a big target for spirit. You know, and spirit do connect very, very easily with children because of the amount of energy. But that then sort of calms down, and then back into teenage years, when the hormone effect comes on, again, we're going back into big effects of energy that's given off, and it does bring all kinds of manifestations.
Yeah, I mean, just on without spirit getting involved, parents will know there's nothing worse than a hormonal teenager.
Well, this is it. And
unless there's a hormonal poltergeist.
Andy 707 has jumped into this, even though he's only just contacted us. I'd like to know who he's with, if that's possible, which group he's with. But he said he's investigated a couple of very active poltergeist incidences. One was actually in a church and there was no children around. Mm-hmm. Joe said while they were watching the film on Monday at the house, a woman was heard crying coming from upstairs. And Danny 123 said there was a big case in Essex recently where there was a young lad being tormented by a poltergeist, but the research hasn't been released yet. Now
can I just say,
yeah?
On that,
uh-huh.
Poltergeists are usually connected around children.
Usually, you know? Yeah.
But that's not the case. Poltergeists can form anywhere.
Yeah.
You know, it doesn't necessarily mean you have to have a child in the vicinity.
Same as last week. Previously with... Oh, right, okay. Hi, Andy.
An energy to connect into.
Yeah.
I've been asleep since then and had a birthday. Well, what I will say is, if you can read that running along the screen... Okay, it does say it's your turn to get involved. You could have got involved earlier, but you did on the chat room. So you can call us via Skype at ktpf.paranormalshow or phone 0844 414 3982 if you want to tell us your experiences regarding poltergeist, if you want to ask any questions to John and Neil and on this subject. So don't forget, as I said before, you need to get involved. Give us a call.
And I'll put my two pennies in as well.
Go on then, two pennies.
No, when they ask the question.
Oh, right, okay.
Because I'm bad to think of something.
Poltergeist activity. Now, I've heard it actually revolves around where there's quartz in the area as well. That's what I've heard. I don't know how true it is.
There's
a theory.
I don't think that's particularly poltergeist. I think... quartz being an energy crystal, it helps with a bit like the stone tape theory. It helps with EVPs. It's you're able to get spirits in general. Because
Andy said he's heard that too.
Because it is a crystal that emits an energy.
It does emit energy, yeah.
Well, that's what we need, Andy. I don't mind you being here all night talking.
Yeah, come talk.
A poltergeist activity usually does interfere with electrical, and telephone.
Yeah.
It can have a huge drain on the power source.
When you see it on the TVs though, and on the films where these tables are standing precariously with the chairs and what have you, can that really happen?
Yes.
Yeah, it does
it
happen.
Can.
If you were to meet my mother, ask her, and she'll tell you all about it. Right.
Can I just say, can you not do it when I'm doing an investigation? Because then it might look good.
It does when you least expect it.
I'm also slightly confused here.
Okay.
Because we've just said that poltergeists stack things.
Yes.
Which means they have to go up. Now, not so long ago, we were talking about this, and Mr. Steve Mayer said, but it doesn't go up, it goes sideways.
No, that's when they're throwing stuff, isn't
it? Well, how do you think the table gets up and...
No, but these were precariously put up on... Like, the table will be on top of... Precariously standing on top of the chair, and the chair would be hanging off the side of the table in a weird way, modern art. This is what I mean.
It's not... The films portray things over-exaggerated.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when I say stack things, in my case, things like tins of beans would be took out of the cupboard and stacked.
Yeah.
On the floor.
Right.
And then 2 seconds later, she'd go back in the kitchen and they'd all be put away back neatly into the cupboard.
Right.
And yet there's nobody in the kitchen.
Okay.
Yeah. There was a pub that John told us about. I think it was the Billy Goat in...
Yes, somewhere up there, Mottram Way.
Mottram Way, they had, that was haunted, and they used to stack crisp boxes in the cellar.
Yeah.
You go down there and
that was useful then, wasn't it?
There'd be a stack of crisp boxes in the middle of the room.
If the amount of energy that's involved with a poltergeist phenomenon is huge. Mm. I went to do an exorcism at a pub, and I had a full barrel of beer thrown at me across the cellar, and it stuck in the wall. And the indentation's still there, I believe, in the pub in Mansfield. You know, we'd just close the door, come out the cellar, we'd close the door. I told the manager to get out quick. As soon as we closed the door, it was thrown right across the cellar, from one end to the other.
What was that?
And it was a full barrel of beer.
That wasn't the one where we went?
No.
Right,
no. Okay. There's, Nigel just said here, they can open doors that have been wedged shut by chairs. He's witnessed this strangely enough, with my mum coming into my bedroom too.
Is this rare though, this phenomenon? Because if say for instance you're in an investigation and they throw a coin, do you class that as poltergeist activity, John?
It depends on the circumstances,
right,
you're in.
Okay. So how would you know then, John, if you've got poltergeist activity? What's the story here? What's the actual evidence?
Again, it depends on who you're with and where you're at.
Yeah.
As Neil said, it could be a pub or a house or a factory or even an open situation.
Mm.
It's not just limited to a specific area.
Yeah, I mean, I would have thought just moving things around was poltergeist activity.
Yeah.
But
yeah, as I say,
I've been told not.
Usually starts low level at something. You wouldn't even take any notice of it, put it to the back of your mind. Things go missing, things reappear, and you wouldn't take much notice of it. You put it down to a bit of absent-mindedness, and then it'll escalate into something like puddles of water appearing on the floor in a particular shape and holding the shape, and fire. You can start fires in cupboards and in drawers. Just on small items and burn nothing else around it. Electrical activity, like you were saying before.
It looks like Simply Joe has said that we had a big stone thrown. I don't know where she is at the time when this happened. And we went looking and found 3 stones. I put them in a circle. And when we went back 10 minutes later, they were in a line. Oh, Nottingham Town Hall.
Yeah, and... Andy said that the one they did in the church, they would make small patterns.
Yeah,
patterns are small stones.
Patterns are
And in Kelly's, Kelly's old flat, she had a stereo that switched on when unplugged and things were going missing. So is that the sort of things they do?
Yeah.
It's sort of like mischievous activity, like a small child would do.
Yeah, but I'm saying, couldn't that just be a spirit trying to get attention?
It depends, because...
And not necessarily a poltergeist.
Usually a poltergeist, it's the same spirit energy that will ramp up its energy the more you ignore it. Mm-hmm. So it will get worse and worse and worse until something is done with that energy.
Yeah.
Whereas if it's just a spirit trying to get in touch with you and you ignore it, it will give up at some stage.
Yeah.
Because but it does react to you as well.
Yeah.
Like Neil was saying, he asked him whatever it was to, can he do better, and it did. It sort of responded directly to. So it ramp up to becoming like a full apparition, and with a voice, and the voice will react to what you ask it to do or not do. You know, it'll start playing even more tricks, but they can get a bit darker as it goes along.
I mean, it kind of sounds like it's every paranormal investigator's dream.
It is. Yeah. It does but sound like that, doesn't it?
Having said that, it can get quite nasty.
Yeah.
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 It can. Yeah.
Yeah, it can.
Especially when there's children involved. You know, that's when it does start playing tricks and it does deviate, and you know, and some of the things that you've got to take care of is you've got to take control of the situation. And not let that have control. You know.
Yeah.
There's just lots of things that you need to put in place.
But that's a bit hard for your everyday Joe.
Yeah.
But do you have to have to bring the priest in, or you know?
People do bring priests in for exorcisms, traditional exorcisms, but they don't always take. It can manifest again.
Yeah.
Stronger, possibly afterwards, but they do tend to, after a while, they peak and then they gradually drop away, and there was no more effect, so the person or the property.
That's really good, interesting. Joe said about Notley Town Hall. That's one of our favourite.
It is one of them. Yeah. We always get playground.
Ghostwise said when he visited Kelly's flat, there was a lot of activity, and he even got a name on a tape recorder.
People often give these poltergeist names, in the Pontefract case, I think they call it Fred. Just give it innocuous names. There's one in Wales that called it Brother Dolly. A lot of them appear as monks for some reason, or a monk-like figure, you know, with a cowl and that's what people describe it as.
Yeah.
Whether it actually is or just Matt takes that particular shape.
That's really. I found that when I was a kid in my great nan's house, if the door opened, they'd come in, Charlie.
People sort of accept it.
Yeah, I mean, they weren't into ghosts or spirituals or anything like that, but for some reason they just called it Charlie. And then they'd come in, Charlie. Can you shut the door behind you?
Yeah, it makes it easier.
He never did, but he never did shut the door.
Regarding the hi-fi, they said that the hi-fi made a low hum, but when asked if it was a child, the hi-fi made a loud buzzing.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know.
So it was kind of answering.
Yeah, it was kind of answering, but whether that
was... What I was saying earlier on, they do deceive you. You know, they could come across as a child when they're not. You know, and then
it could be something else entirely, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, the thing with sort of poltergeist activity... a lot of it is deceiving you, and they will trick you because they don't want to be moved on.
No.
You know, they do want to cause havoc sometimes, to the extent where they want to do damage. You know, so you've got to be very, very careful.
You got this big ball of energy to play with, and as Colin Wilson described it in his book Poltergeist, which was written about this case, if people want to read up, you know, the real actual case.
Yeah.
And the film sort of exaggerates, pulls things together over a year, but it happened over a longer period, and that will fill in all the background for them. So it's a very large tome, and not particularly scary bedtime reading, but it's very interesting to read.
And what was that again?
The book's called Poltergeist by Colin Wilson.
Can I just get you guys to put everybody straight on something, and it's mainly it's probably totally down to Hollywood, but poltergeist is always portrayed as demonic.
Well, that in Steven Spielberg's movie it became even more so. Initially on the opening sequences, they used what could be described as, you know, the original poltergeist phenomenon, that's the stacking of the chairs, things moving. a gradual build up, but obviously he goes for the big effects blowout, as it goes on, more and more spectacular events, and with the subsequent movies got even more wilder.
As a film, I actually loved The Entity. I thought it was a really good film.
Mm. It was a good film, as a Hollywood-style movies go.
Yeah, the only thing with it is it makes you wonder, because it's Hollywood, how much of it was true, because it was actually based on supposedly a true incident.
With Spielberg, it's usually based on multiple incidents, and he crams everything together into one storyline.
Mm-hmm. Raking Deb says, would poltergeists have been noisy or disruptive in their life on Earth, so they carry on in their afterlife? Now, to me, is poltergeist just actually an energy?
That's
or
just
is
spirit,
it,
isn't it?
Yeah. Or is it a spirit that's turned...
A lot of the poltergeist phenomena I've dealt with has been energy that's not walked this Earth before. So it hasn't actually lived down on this plane.
Right.
The only way I can sort of can't explain it really. You do get some poltergeist phenomena that, yes, that would have been a bit naughty down here when they lived down here, and they're just carrying on where they left off really. But a lot of what I've dealt with hasn't been down on this plane before.
Right.
There's the question is from
and that's where people sort of get this demonic or demons from things that they've seen and appear, and it's just it's a mask that they put on.
Reiki Deb says, so it's just an energy, it's not a spirit in most cases. That's what I thought.
It is a spirit. It is a spirit, but it's a spirit that's not walked this plane before.
Right,
so there's loads of weird and wonderful things that people haven't seen in the spirit world.
Yeah.
Because that it hasn't been down on this plane.
Right.
So things could appear to you that would be undescribable to you, because you wouldn't be able to, you wouldn't know what it was. So it is actually a spirit form, because I've dealt with poltergeists that have been physical.
Yeah.
If it was just energy, it wouldn't been able to do what it's done.
Have the team ever heard of this house in Essex? I know you said there's not much come out yet, but or somebody said. Yeah, but
the teenage boy who lived with his grandparents being bothered by the poltergeist.
Have you heard this?
No, I haven't heard of this one so far. No.
No. Perhaps you're right, the story hasn't really come out much yet.
That one's new to the team at the moment.
Food for thought, says Deb. Thanks. So I'm just going to Google it, see whether I can find any more on it here. See whether we can enlighten ourselves.
Poltergeist in Essex.
There's a lot happening in Essex of late, I must admit. What with, the cat that was a cat.
Shut up.
Did you see that picture I sent you with the birdies?
Yes, I did. Yes. Shut up.
Okay. Essex Enfield poltergeist investigator dies. That was in 2006. I'm not seeing much here at the moment that's on Google.
It's just coming up in Essex, the Enfield one.
This is recent, was it? 2012. I just tried, Suzanne, couldn't find anything. Tell me about it, I live in Essex. Do you, Andy? Okay. Nothing's really coming up, to be honest with you, at the moment. Perhaps, like you say, it's not news at the moment. The story's not out there. Okay, so they had video evidence of stones being dropped and stuff being moved. Now, it was about 5 years ago. Oh, right, okay. So we're talking 2007, maybe? Yeah.
Well, that would be 5 years ago. So it's basically they've taken this. I kind of like this now, because they've taken time to analyse all the evidence and what they've got, and so hopefully when it does come out, it'll be they won't be able to pick so many holes in it, because there's so many times on, not just on poltergeist, but people doing reports and stuff, and they rush to get it out, and people just pick so many holes in it, and it kind of falls by the wayside then, and it might be an authentic thing they're talking about, because they've rushed it. They've left it open for, yeah. for people to pick yeah. holes in it.
They've Nothing right seems to be around, coming up, unfortunately. So
nothing there. So
see, it depends on who's involved in it and yeah. what the property is, and because you know a lot of it is done, you know,
on the hush hush.
On the hush hush.
Yeah.
You know, and you're not allowed to talk about it, and it's never in any reports. You know,
the last thing you want is the media to be involved.
Well, well this
exactly,
is it.
Exactly. Yeah,
which is. Which is a point in their favour, in their favour, because it that alone says they're not in it. Whoever's doing the investigation are not in it for publicity.
Mm. Yeah,
which is good.
No, not finding anything on that, Dernie. Sorry, Mia Dolan was investigating it apparently. Oh, is it this Walthamstow one? God, now you're asking me. I don't think Walthamstow is in Essex, is it?
I don't know, but tell us about it, Joe.
Yeah, tell us about it.
Nigel said Andy Collins investigation.
Mm. So
is that the one we've been talking about, Nigel?
No, I don't think so.
He said Andy Collins investigation.
Walthamstow poltergeist. Hold on. Poltergeist 2007.
Danny says, look on YouTube, there's a few vids of it.
Right.
With Mia Dolan commenting.
The second visit. East London family, it says.
Oh, it's just what she found on Google when she typed in.
Yeah, that's East London.
Yeah, she typed in 2007 Essex poltergeist.
I'll have to look for that one for next week.
The Black Alchemist.
That was the Black Monk of Pontefract, that one. Yeah. That which is the current.
Is that the current
film.
One?
Yeah, the film.
The Black Alchemist.
Black Alchemist was a book by Andy Collins.
Right. Okay.
It was a separate thing entirely.
Right. Okay.
What have you got here?
Well, I'm reading out the. Magazine called the Fortean Times, which covers a lot of poltergeist phenomena in this particular issue. People want to read up, including the current film, of course. And the one I'm particularly interested in here, it's based in South Shields and Tyneside in 2006. The case here was in a private house, and it's witnessed and researched by two people. At an early stage, the edge sightings were in raps on the walls, scratches on one of the residents, and examples of matter penetration, you know, that's teleportation. And also with a remarkable apparition. And attempts at communication at the poltergeist suggesting rudimentary malevolent intelligence at work. And it says here at least a dozen reliable witnesses and photographs and recordings made at the location await further analysis. The two guys doing this wrote a book on this one as well, so that's available. It's called... The South Shields Poltergeist. That came out in 2010. Mm. And the two guys were out doing several lecture tours describing the events and what they've seen and heard themselves. So that's a really interesting case for people, and look up that one as well.
Yeah, so there's some there for you to look at.
I'm actually wondering, all these things we're talking about as investigators are something that we would like to find.
Mm.
But how many of us would actually stay put?
Yeah.
And not
this is it.
And not need clean underwear
many.
And run.
Well yeah, that's many. your basic source of early warning radars, something where you want to run out the house, you know, that you don't want to witness it. But in our case, we go in and want to witness it, don't we? You know, that's we do the reverse thing. Your natural sort of defence is saying, don't hang ground.
Something happens and it's oh shit!
Language.
What was that? And it's like, I don't know. Could you shut up? I might be out of hear it again.
Run away, Nigel says. May run at first, but would like to go. I have to go back.
Yeah, but
night, Shabal. Thanks for coming on, my love.
Yeah, no.
Right, I've got going into the paranormal news bit here that maybe we can do some discussion on. It is one that follows on from that. A Catholic priest claims to have cleansed evil house after widow sees spirit of dead husband appear on the bedroom wall. A terrified widow called for priest to cleanse her evil house after she claimed to have seen her dead husband appear on her bedroom wall. Andrea Samuels said the strange shape on her wall and ceiling is her husband Brian, who died 4 years ago. The 41-year-old also claims her dead dog is calling for her beyond the grave in the bathroom of her Carlisle home. Okay, I'll just go down a bit. She called for Catholic priest Father Paul Dadson, who used holy water to cleanse the property on Wednesday. Andrea, who believes the animal in her ceiling is her dead boxer Hoob, said her house has been the sense of numerous inexplicable events. She claims brand new furniture has broken, pictures have fallen off walls, and that she has suffered personal problems since the images first appeared. She also believes that one of her pet birds, the aptly named Spirit, flew away after getting caught in all the strange happenings. Her second bird, Spook, weird, is now the only one that is left. She says... she goes on to describe as being in good psychological and emotional health by the priest, and says, I used to have a beautiful home and it just went. Upon his arrival, the father scattered holy water around the building, blessed it and said some prayers. He arrived in Carlisle in January after working as a priest in Botswana and his native Nigeria for 13 years. He said that it was the second time he has carried out this kind of spiritual cleansing in the city. He goes on to say, I was there and saw something on the wall which looked to me like some kind of image. From a distance, it appeared like the figure of a man. In some houses, things have been done. Many people have carried out some kind of sacrifice or other activity that influences people with the forces of evil. The homeowner, Andrea, who has lived in a Carlisle home for 10 years, now hopes the blessing will help her to move on with her life and says it has helped her discover her religious faith. So what do you think to that?
I'm sorry,
my first question.
We're looking at religious...
Why do you have a bird called Spook and Spirit?
No. I mean, if you look at that whole story, it's a complete chaos in itself. Because one, a Catholic priest believes that there's spirit there. And he's getting rid of spirit. And I thought they didn't believe in it.
And he said, why would it be evil just because she saw him on the wall?
Also saying it's her ex-husband. Would you want to get rid of your ex-husband? Unless he was he did something bad in his past.
And her pet dog.
And her pet dog. I mean, why would you want
to... Wouldn't her pet dog be more likely to look after her?
Exactly.
Than do anything.
I don't know,
but as I say, that's Andy says it's nuts.
Should leave a bonio up for the dog.
Yeah, to me, it's probably a bold statement, but it sounds to me like you've got a touch of religious fervor here. You've also got, I think, that the lady needs some counselling.
Maybe she
a bit of company would have done.
Yeah, company would have done, but. The only thing of that whole story that I can't really understand is new furniture breaking.
Yeah.
Unless you bought it from MFI, in which case it always breaks.
The lady certainly needs therapy, said Andy 707. Right, okay, the next paranormal news we've got, we're going down the cryptozoology trail, I'm afraid. We're going to the North Cotswolds. Has anyone been in the Mildene Garden? in Blockley lately, because there's been a spooky set of huge footprints found that has baffled people in the Cotswolds. Melanie Aston, who teaches swimming at Mildene and often takes her dog for a walk in Bolton Woods on Saturday mornings, found some large unshod footprints near the toilets by the car park early this month.
Barefoot in other words.
Okay. Her size 7 wellies were dwarfed by the huge prints, which she said seemed fresh. However, she could not see anyone else around. They went over some really rough ground, but there was quite a distance between each print, almost as if they were avoiding the really wet mud, she said. They went right down to where the path goes over the brook, then divides into three directions, which is where I lost track. It's really quite spooky, and I'm not such a frequent visitor since. Mildene owner Wendy Dare said, I honestly have no idea what it is. The footprints are very large. And they're saying, the headline is Bigfoot in the North Cotswolds. What do you reckon, guys?
Right.
Do you think we've got one?
No.
No.
First of all, if you've got a foot that dwarfs a size 7, I'm sure Neil's feet would dwarf a size 7.
They look like it anyway.
They look quite big. But if you've got somebody that's 6 foot plus tall, there's a good bit they're going to have at least 12, maybe a 13 size shoe.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. So they're going to have a big footprint. The only and with that they're going to be a large stride.
Yeah.
So it would look as if they're trying to avoid things.
And if somebody's running, you take large strides, don't you?
Yeah. And also there is, it might not be barefoot, because there are some running shoes that are actual feet.
Mm.
And so they're like a second skin to your foot, and it's supposed to be that you helps the helps you to run better, because you haven't got shoes and stuff to worry about.
It could be a hoax, of course. Someone spoofing it, you know.
Might be the giant kangaroo wearing shoes. Simply Joe said.
Yeah.
Simply Joe said that her mate has got size 14 feet.
Yeah. Wow! How tall is your mate, Joe?
God!
My friend actually has size 17 feet. He has to have them specially made.
God!
He's 7 foot two.
Wow.
So, you know.
Did you see recently, somewhere in the foreign lands, there was actually a young kid whose feet are growing quicker than what she is, or he is. And I think they're about 4 or 5 years old, and they've got the feet of a man. You know, I don't know whether it was I don't know whether it was a fake thing. I didn't really look.
There is actually a disease out there that makes parts of your body grow bigger than normal. I mean, there was a lady that was on a documentary not so long ago, and she had huge legs. You know, and she was born with these huge legs.
This is it.
You know, who's to say it's not somebody with massive feet? You know.
Andy 707 said it's just a big foot.
I'd be more inclined to think it's basically a tall person going for a run in them shoes that I said.
Yeah, there are some shoes like that that's got feet on the bottom.
Are they two left feet though? Or two right?
Maybe. I don't know.
And forget about Bigfoot. I saw on the CFZ today.
Oh yeah.
Littlefoot.
Littlefoot?
Littlefoot.
And what's Littlefoot?
I didn't go into the story, but I just saw the headline.
So there's a Littlefoot, is there?
There's a Littlefoot somewhere.
Oh, I don't know. So I'll just see if I can quickly find that. Or is it on the CFC, Centre for Fortean?
Yeah, on the CFC.
Nick Redfern. He'll be coming on the show sometime. Got to sort out a date with him. But he's found a Littlefoot, and that's not going very far. Here we go.
Joe said that, sir. She's a size 3.
She's a size 3. God. We've all heard of the antics of Bigfoot. What about Littlefoot? Certainly, it's an undeniable fact that many reports emanating from Britain tell of encounters with not just large and lumbering, hairy entities, but the distinctly small critters, too. Creatures, century-old Welsh folklore folklore again. Yeah. That's back to you, John. For example, tales of the, oh God, how do you pronounce this? The Bwabach or something. B-W-B-A-C-H.
Have you heard of that one, John?
And an approximately 3 foot tall, hair-covered humanoid perceived by the folk that era as a brownie or nymph.
Yeah, the brown house brownie, again. That display poltergeist-like activity around the house. The house brownie was supposed to be helpful, doing all kinds of odd jobs around the house of an evening and on the farm. If you left, you know, food and stuff out for it. But apparently, if you left clothes out for it, it'd turn nasty and then leave. Because they always had to be without clothes.
Really?
Couldn't wear clothes. Wow. And that was like the biggest insult you could give to it.
Yeah, good night, Danny. I'm glad you enjoyed the show.
Yeah, good night. I'll see you next week as well. We'd love to phone in up next week and talk more. Do so, Danny. That's what we're here for. We want to hear from you as well.
And he said he would like a brownie with a coffee.
We want to hear from you. That's what we're here for. We can talk more about succubuses that you've witnessed. We want to hear your stories, okay? We are here to share. All right, me and Steve and Neil are part of UK Shadow Seekers, but we are actually looking to keep the paranormal friendly and find out your experiences as well. And we also want groups coming on to promote themselves. And if anyone's got a book or whatever, as I say, we've got Sixth Sense Paranormal next week, and we've also got Nigel Mortimer coming on about his sundial and talking about his book Isaac Newton and the Sundial.
But, can you go on to,
hello,
you're online there?
I am, yeah.
Go into my radio tab.
Your radio tab, yep.
I think it's near the bottom about the home book review thing.
Home, the preview review?
Yeah.
All right, yeah.
If you'd like to tell everybody about that thing, they've come up, they're doing reviews on books, DVDs and CDs and all sorts.
Yeah, it's paranormalreview.moonfruit.com. And they are doing reviews on books, DVDs, and other reviews, etc. So
I was actually thinking about doing a review for me each week, but some of them can be quite long.
Yes, this is it. So
I'd have a condensed one.
If you want to have a look there's quite a few on there.
It was crap.
So
it's so.
But that sort of suits it up.
But going back to the paranormal news, what there is of it, this isn't actually. I don't think this is. Thanks for that, team. That's no problem. Okay. This isn't actually something you can say hasn't happened, because it is going to happen. On September the 15th.
It's going to happen.
It's going to happen. Derek Acora and Richard Felix are starting their psychic and science show at the Eye of York, September 15th. Harry Martindale, the York heating engineer, who famously saw Roman soldiers marching through the ceiling wall of the treasurer's house in 1953, will relive his teenage experience at the York Ghost Fest 2012. I don't know whether any of you are going there.
Through the ceiling wall. Isn't that a contradiction in terms?
Yeah,
through the ceiling wall.
Through the walls, apparently. Mm.
Harry is the guest celebrity to be interviewed at Derek Cora's and Richard Felix's Psychic and Science Show on September the 15th at the Eye of York in front of Clifford's Tower on the world's first interactive paranormal theatre tour. Derek and Richard first worked together on Living TV's Most Haunted and are now embarking on their travels to educate the public on the realities of the paranormal. Wow. Harry's story is, in our opinion, possibly the best ghost story in the world, says the two godfathers of the paranormal. Who's called them the godfathers?
I don't know. I don't know, but what you're saying, that Andy said that he visited the house and it's interesting sight.
Okay. The Psychic and Science Show will break away from the normal Hollywood or TV ghost show, where the scare factor was always prominent.
Didn't somebody do this last year with Kieran O'Keefe.
I can't remember
who the medium was.
Don't know. Instead, we'll conduct various experiments and demonstrations.
Yeah. I think it was Billy Roberts.
And test series to open people's eyes and prove that the realities behind ghosts are far more fascinating than the Scooby-Doo side of things.
Scooby-Doo.
Well,
Scrappy's downstairs.
I know she is. Joe said Compass did it with Chris Conway. You should, right, really could, should visit it too. Amazing story. I will do next time I'm there, Andy. I doubt whether they'll let us in, though, to investigate it. No, not there. They're on about something else. Good night, guys. Great show. Yeah, and we'll be on next week to harass the 50-year-old baldly. Good on ya. We'll also have some guys in the hub as well. Night, Joe. As I was saying, the September 15th show in England's most haunted city will be hosted by Ed Felix, if nobody knows who he is, that's Richard's son, who, despite being a sceptic, has been heavily involved in the world of the paranormal for 10 years. Throughout next Saturday's gathering, audience members will be randomly selected to take part in a psychic and scientific experiment with David and Richard. Derek and Richard. Why do I keep calling him David? The evening will feature a psychic fair, readings from Derek Acora, and Richard Felix's explanation of his theories on what a ghost really is. Further events will be glass divination, table tilting, and a human pendulum with audience participation, and a question and answer session with Derek and Richard, and the Harry Martindale's interview. See, there's all this stuff going on and nobody knows about it.
Well, it's their own fault. They should have put it on Paranormal Events for you.
Yes.
And then everybody would know about it.
Yes, if you've got an event, why don't you put it on ParanormalEventsForYou.com? It's the free advertising website, so you don't have to wade through all the other activities that other advertisers include. So you won't find any paranormal investigations or events in between jumble sales and summer fates. So why don't you have a look? And advertise, just don't put the price, just your URL to your website. And you must have an active website. No Facebook pages, please. Thank you.
And did you hear the little word there with a big meaning? Free.
Free.
It cost
definitely
you nothing,
free.
Guys.
Yes, so get your word out there. It's the only place where you can actually advertise paranormal events, period. Nothing else, full stop, in other words. I was going to go, but didn't fancy sitting on the ground, especially if it's raining. Oh, what? Right, yeah, I see what you mean, yeah.
Where's she going?
She was going to go to, what's her name? Saturday night, up there, wherever, York.
All right.
Why don't you sit down in Liverpool then?
It's an outside event.
I think so, yeah. It's party in the park style.
No, we'll definitely be wet and windy then, won't it?
Definitely. Looks like the weather's not too good, is it? But that's the paranormal news. There's not been much around of late. Some of it's rehashed up and been coming on for ages.
They've got a real bad habit of rehashing. So
yeah.
I think a lot of the internet people that are doing that are taking lessons from the red tops.
Yeah. See, I could actually bring on some UFO sightings, but I'm trying to make a mix and match of everything.
I mean,
so.
I was actually going through some of them the other day, and I'm looking, well, that's interesting. And when I've actually opened it up, it's a story I read last month with a different name, a different title.
Yeah, I must admit, it does come really back in, you know, it's a bit like full circle skirts. They go out in the 50s or 60s, they come back in the 70s, and they've gone again.
You ladies did look good in the full circle.
So, anyway, but yeah, so what have we got coming on next week?
Coming soon.
Woo-hee! I do love that, coming soon.
We have Nige.
We have Nigel Mortimer. Yes. Who is Nigel Mortimer? That's what I'd like to know. But he hangs around some wood up in Settle area.
Well, we'll listen next week and we'll tell you.
Yes. Nigel Mortimer says he believes that there are portals, interdimensional portals in the world. And he's actually says he's found one in North Yorkshire.
Well, I don't know about the one he's found, but I believe him. I do think there are these portals. I think a lot of people confuse them with time slips.
Yes.
I think that's part of the problem.
Let me just answer Andy. The show starts at 8 o'clock, Andy, and it normally lasts 2 hours, depending on the subject. Sometimes it goes on until roughly half past 10.
Basically, as long as we've still got something to talk about and you're still asking questions, we will, within reason, keep going.
Yes. So, as I say, next week we have ufologist and paranormal researcher Nigel Mortimer, and he believes he has found convincing evidence that interdimensional portals really do exist, and one of these can be found in North Yorkshire in England. His website states this is a real life quest unlike anything that has been attempted before. Okay, so you're going to find out all about that next week.
Well, without hearing what Nigel's found and the facts of the case, what do you think of the idea?
I know Nigel from quite a long time ago. Used to visit, go to Yorkshire, in different part of Yorkshire, where he used to live in Ilkley
area. That.
Yeah, well, Ilkley Moor has several swastika stone up on the top, and Cow and Calf Rocks and White Wells, which is well known in UFO circles for the alien picture, allegedly taken as it was with an extra long arm going taken from behind and moving up the towards the top of the hill with a box type feature, which people described as some sort of alien craft. What's interesting in that area is Cow and Calf Rocks has experienced all kinds of light anomalies and time slips and the well-known fairy activity. White Wells itself, one particular story goes with the gate, the curator, the key to open the baths up one morning, and as he inserted the key into the lock, it rotated by itself, and it took ages to open the door, and it's got the missing time episode here. As he opened the door, all these little creatures he described were in the baths and imitating human activity. On seeing him, they all vanished out the baths and ran up the slopes and onto the hill and the surrounding area. So the whole area has got numerous strange activity and UFOs, ancient sites, the Black Dog, Phantom Black Dog, of course, and strange lights and ancient monuments, amongst other things. But Nigel was in that area and he's done a lot of research on that, so I'm sure you can ask him on that as well.
Yeah, he's put on here, those were the days, eh, John?
Yeah, I managed to get up there a couple of times and actually see where it was. And he was with another researcher called Paul Bennett, who used to find numerous ancient sites which are never recorded or overlooked by supposed, archaeologists of ancient, yesteryear and modern times. We never bothered. We didn't even know it was there. So they were actual real rediscoveries of these ancient sites. And it's not too far from Cottingley on the other side of the moor. Rumble's Moor, Rumble was supposed to be a giant haunted that lived on the moor. And through a stone-throwing giant, which became the ancient monuments, stone circles and standing stones. I was saying Cottingley, but for the well-known Cottingley fairy story, is just on the other side of the moor, which I never got to visit, unfortunately. So,
yeah, well, he's put on there that finding of the portal is part of that Ilkley journey.
Yeah, I'm sure Nigel's been on this one for quite some
time.
What do you think? What do you think, Neil?
Neil? Portals?
I think they exist.
Yeah.
I think the reason why you can't find them is that they're hidden for that reason, so people can't find them.
Yeah.
If you've left portals all around, around a place like that is a dangerous thing, don't you think?
Yeah, you won't particularly want everybody to find them, would you?
But yeah, so I think there is something along that line. I don't know whether it's a portal or whether it's some kind of gateway or whatever. But
is this same as a vortex sort of thing, would you say, or is it something different?
It's a gateway, isn't it? Yeah. Into another dimension.
Well, the only thing that worries me is that the only way of truly proving that is to go through it.
Just to go through it
and come back again.
Yeah. Well, don't forget, guys, if you want to ever ring up and talk to our guest and ask them questions, that's what they're there for, that's what the phone lines are for, and that's what the Skype's for. So if you want to do that, you can Skype on ktpf.paranormalshow or phone on 0844 414 3982, and we'll be willing to take any questions, or you can just get involved in the conversations. Even if you want to just Skype and become part of the show by talking in general. Okay? Andy said, do you guys think places like Stonehenge mark such sites?
I think there is definitely something in or to do with Stonehenge. I mean, I've been to Stonehenge a couple of times now, and I've stood in the middle, I've stood in the centre, I've been around the outside, and some of the things that I've picked up, energy-wise.
Yeah.
Well, they built a lot of these stone sites over water courses, which generates certain amounts of piezoelectricity through the stones, and that's maybe why the ancients built these sites, because the light anomalies were seen there, and that was maybe one of the reasons they actually put the stones up. Besides, you know, marking the points to do with the moon and the sun and the stars.
Well, there was actually something on YouTube this week. I'm not sure if it's been put on just this week, but it was mentioned this week, of a ghost caught on tape, on footage, and I'm going to share this with those in the hub.
Yeah, and Andy was saying about the underground. And
but if you can just see this, it shows you in a bit.
Oh, yeah, I've seen that one.
Yeah. It's on that... Let's get rid of that. Typical. Yeah. I'll show this in a minute. Put you the link on. But it's just looking here. See? It'll slow it down. See here? And it's like you can see a young lad.
Supposed to be a shadow, isn't it?
Right, let me just pause that for a second so I can give it to those in the hub to have a look at.
You mean on the chat room, you mean?
Chat room. I keep saying hub. Right. Okay, if you want to go and have a look, we're having a look at it as we speak. We're on the slowed down bit. So, as you can see. Yeah. Now, I don't know how true that is, but it says the new ghost footage of a little boy ghost that has been roaming around the ancient site of Stonehenge. This clip was taken by one of the camera crew men, but was not spotted until the clip was being reviewed for editing.
You can actually see as the camera comes round.
Yeah.
Goes down on his haunches.
There is no question now that the little boy spirit comes out to play in the daylight. So, did you see that all right, John? Did you want to just see that again? Oh, those silly adverts. See, you've got that there. Quite tall for a little boy, though.
Yeah.
That was my feeling. You know.
Yeah, but if you talk
and it's quite white.
Not really good. If you're talking about shadow, yeah, then the shadow doesn't necessarily depict the size of the person.
No.
It depends on where the light's coming from.
Yeah. Hi, Gary. You're a bit late, darling, but.
What was the question, Ghost Rider? I didn't see a question.
I used to work at the Stratford and had many things.
Station, yeah.
Steve, I asked a question. Oh,
I missed the question.
Missed the question. Hold on. Where are we? Bit of a weird question for you all. What is your opinion on the shadow people who are supposed to roam on the London Underground Network?
No, it's not just the Underground, is it? They're all over the...
They are all over
the world.
We'll have to get hold of that guy who's writing a book on shadow people.
Yes, have you got his?
Yeah, I've got his website.
Yeah, can you stick it up for people, because he wants information?
Oh, I see if it's still on here.
On shadow people.
Oh, you're seeing me on the stage. Here we go. No, we're not.
What?
Well, I thought it was here. No,
we'll
seemed to have lost
it. Find it for you guys. We've definitely got to find it because we've got to get in touch with him.
Got to get in touch with him. It's probably somewhere when we've changed around.
Yeah, because he's actually looking for people's...
Right, well, Andy thinks it's total fake. No, not what you were saying, that thing there.
I hadn't finished saying.
Oh, sorry.
It could be just another Photoshop.
Yeah, it could be.
Yeah, that could be. But this gentleman, who his name escapes me. But
Matty,
we will get it to you. He's looking for people's experiences with seeing and... shadow people, and
yeah,
he's writing a book about it,
yeah,
and he's trying to get as many,
it's around somewhere,
view of it as he can,
yeah, so he's looking for that sort of thing.
Yes, he came to the Weird Weekend and put out the announcement, didn't he?
Yeah, so anyway, guys, the time is fleeting again,
it is,
don't forget, we are here
every Wednesday night,
yeah, that's right, we're here every Wednesday night at 8 p.m. Okay.
This is where it's at.
And we will be bringing you all the news and gossip and interviews and discussions for you to join in with. Okay. And don't forget, you heard it here first. Ben Hansen from Paranormal Files, Fact or Fate, or Fact or Fate Paranormal Files, will be joining us sometime next year, meeting up. So if you're interested,
yep, we got to find a place to do a meet and greet,
and then an investigation with the lads. So
that would be cool.
So you heard it here first.
Well, I know at least 6 or 7 women that will want to come.
Yeah, yeah. He was definitely looking at your comments about how fit he looked and his bottom and God knows what else. Yeah.
Rosie was being a hussy.
But we'll keep you informed. As I say, I've got his contact on Skype, and I'm not giving it out, I'm afraid.
Well, I'm sure we can work with Rosie and Stuart and try and sort out a venue as well.
Yes, definitely. So guys, if you're interested in joining us and the Paranormal Files Fact or Fake team, or at least, well, I know there's Ben and Bill that's coming over for that Scottish Fringe event that's being taken part there. But if he's still coming over for Series 4, because there's quite a few that he wants to do, if you missed the interview.
And if he's coming over for the fact that he might actually bring the rest of the team over.
Yes, so we might actually sort something out then.
So Jebby might actually be able to ask for the phone number himself.
Yes, definitely. Well, I'm afraid that's it for tonight, as I say. So, you know where it's at. It's here on www.ktpf.co.uk. And we'll be here next week at 8 o'clock. So, until then...
We have to give a big thank you, obviously, to Ben, John and Neil for
helping
us out tonight.
And also for you for listening and for all the questions.
Yes, we had lots of questions tonight, didn't we?
Yeah. So, until next time, please join us again on the show. And... Have a good week. And if you're investigating this Saturday, have a good one, okay? And we'll see you then. Until then, guys, we're keeping the paranormal friendly. Thank you. So good night and God bless. And here's the outro.